People sometimes assume stocks will perform better than bonds and inflation, and that's a mixed track record. So obviously, if you have something like hyperinflation, you'd rather own stocks than bonds. Good amount of inflation compared to the historical average over the past couple decades. And it looks like in certain areas that's rolling over, but it's still quite elevated, especially compared to bond yields. And so investors find themselves that the risk is that if you hold cash or bonds that are yielding 0%, 1%, 2%, while inflation is 4%, 5%, 6%, you're getting devalued, you're losing purchasing power. And so one of the ways that investors can deal with that is to buy Treasury Inflation Protected Securities, or TIPS. And so some countries issue those, as a small part of their sovereign bond market. So my article focused on U.S. TIPS, and basically what they say is, we'll adjust the bond coupon that you're getting based on inflation levels, official CPI in the United States. And so that kind of takes away that risk of inflation. But my whole article focused on the fact that, TIPS can be very useful as an inflation defense, but they're not perfect. And so obviously, if you have that extra inflation protection built into your bond, there's no free lunch. And so that comes with some costs. And so the main cost is that the TIPS yields are lower than normal treasury bonds. And so in the United States currently, you're getting like a negative 1% yield on your TIPS. So you're getting inf you're you know you're basically going to earn inflation minus about 1%. So you're it's ironically you're guaranteed to underperform inflation by owning inflation protected securities, which sounds terrible, but it's one of those things where, right now the 10-year treasury yield is under it's under 1.5%, and the inflation expectations by the market are maybe 2.5%, while inflation is currently 5%. Right, because they're expecting that this is not going to stay at this level for a very long time, and that the average inflation over the course of the, say, the 10-year duration of this bond will be lower in the mid two range. Now, if that's the case, if the inflation expectations are true, then normal bonds and TIPS will have about the same return. They basically are optimized around kind of, that break-even point. However, if inflation ends up being higher than those inflation expectations, like if inflation is 3%, 4%, 5% averaging over the decade, then those TIPS, despite the fact that they will mildly underperform inflation, will still do better than normal treasury yields that are, yielding 1.5% while inflation's, 3, 4, 5%. And so that's the kind of the trade-off that you get by owning TIPS, is that you're not guaranteed to keep up with inflation, but you have more protection if inflation runs notably higher than people expect. The other big risk of TIPS is that you're reliant on a government statistics for inflation, which include a specific basket of goods with hedonic adjustments, and people can debate endlessly about how accurate that measurement is. I've done work on this, and I think it at least mildly understates, quote unquote, true inflation, but everybody has their own unique inflation basket. And so basically, with TIPS, you risk having your official inflation metric not keep up with real inflation, and then you also will mildly underperform even that official metric because of the negative yield. Anyone who has bonds in their portfolio at this time, which is not everyone, right? Because younger investors might choose to exclude bonds because of the poor yields and the inflation, and to focus on other assets and take the higher volatility that comes with that, right? So obviously TIPS might not be ideal for them. But I think anyone who has bonds in a portfolio could benefit from having a percentage of those bonds be TIPS. And so I think this is an environment where, TIPS are, I think, useful to have if you own bonds. It's hard to get sustained inflation while commodity prices stay low. I mean, that generally a history of inflation is a history of commodity price inflation. And it's, commodities historically are very poor performing asset class. If you look over, say, a century of data, commodities are one of the worst places to hold money over a long term, because if you're holding the commodity outright, it doesn't compound, it just sits there. And if you're holding commodity companies, it generally tends to be lower quality businesses. Now, there are some commodity companies that have done very well, especially in energy, because they've been protected by a cartel. for decades. But generally, it's not good to have a company who doesn't control the price of their own product, right? So they generally are not, you know, not the highest quality wide moat businesses that, you know, that might be appreciated. The caveat there is that during an inflationary decade, commodities generally trounce everything else. Like it's not even close. And so in the 70s, it's pretty much all you would want to own. In the 2000s, you know, commodities and emerging markets, which had a lot of commodity exposure, were the way to go. They challenged everything else. And so generally when you have these inflationary decades, you want to have some commodity exposure. And that you know, ideally you want to mix it up a little bit so you're not too focused on one commodity. You don't want to pick the one commodity that maybe doesn't do very well. You know, historically, oil and gas are the biggest commodities. I mean, that market is bigger than all other commodities combined. So, you know, a lot of it comes down to what that's going to do over a given, you know, 3 to 5 year period. But overall, I think, you know, one of the best ways to have protection against inflation is to have commodities and commodity companies. And if someone wants to reduce the risk, they can use commodity trend following, which is basically saying, you know, you're kind of acknowledging that it's not a great asset class to hold long term, and that you generally want to restrict your exposure to them when they're in an upturn, because the upturns can be pretty violently good, right? Just like explosive gains, but then the downside can be brutal in the opposite direction. So I think some sort of either commodity exposure, commodity related investments, could be commodity trend following, could be commodities, could be commodity equities. They're generally the better way. There's also, you know, real estate, if you can get it at appropriate prices, right? Which is harder these days than it was maybe a couple years ago. But obviously certain zip codes, certain regions of the world, of your country, wherever you might live, can be protection against inflation. And partly it's because with real estate, you can leverage it more than most other asset classes without it being silly, right? You can leverage it, you know, with a mortgage, because it's a stable asset. And so what you're essentially doing is you're shorting currency. You're shorting the currency you borrow that in. So if you have a reasonably priced house and you have a 30-year fixed rate mortgage on it at a rate that's, you know, at or below the inflation rate, you're shorting a depreciating asset, and you're going long an appreciating asset. And so that's historically been a better way, at least better than stocks historically. And then when it comes to stocks, you generally want to focus on ones that can control their cost very well. And so, you know, people sometimes assume stocks will perform better than bonds and inflation, and that's a mixed track record. So obviously, if you have something like hyperinflation, you'd rather own stocks than bonds, because bonds will become worthless. Stocks will still be worth something when the dust settles, because you still own productive assets.